go to the Gospel of John. And from the four Gospels, John is sticks out the most, maybe in a way, because he really emphasizes the deity of Christ. How, as a man, he was representing God fully, representing, whilst being a man. And so he focuses a lot on the signs that Jesus gave, and the words that he spoke. And he leaves out a lot of other details that the other gospel writers give us. But yeah, if you put all this together, it's a very rich picture. And I want to go to chapter 15. And I will, a bit later on, I will give a bit more detail about the context of these words, because it's very important, because these words, these verses here in these chapters, 13, 14, 15, until 17, they are often quoted out of context, and even so by non-Christians. And so we have to understand the context. But let's first read John 15, verse 13. It's obviously Jesus speaking here, and he says, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." So what does it mean? If you read it first level, you would think, okay, the greatest thing you can do is to die for a friend. To really, literally, physically die for a friend. Is this what he means? Without context, that's it. But we will see there is more to it. There are two key words in this verse. One is love, because he says there's no greater love. So love is one key word, and then the next key word is friend, because it's to die for a friend. So these are two keywords, and a third one will be added later. Now first, the word love is, in our times and in our language, it's completely devaluated, what the meaning of the word love. Actually, today it has become synonymous with tolerance. To love means to tolerate everything. And so often, as Christians, we are being pressed to compromise and to tolerate all kinds of things that are going on in the world. And when we stick to the Word of God, and we see things happening that are against God's word, and we stand against or speak against them, then it's often the non-Christians that will accuse us for not showing Christian love, as if they know very well what Christian love means. But that's what's happening. They say, you have to show Christian love. What is this now? Why are you against it? Why do you not tolerate? And so this is exactly how the enemy works. He uses God's word against us, against God's people. And that's why it's so important we have to understand the word and the context and the meaning, so that we can answer also with God's word. It's exactly also what Jesus did when he was tempted. It was with the word that he countered Satan's attacks. And actually, in general, that is what we should do when we answer to people that attack us. We answer with the word. We don't need to literally cite all the verses, but if we can say them even in our own words, but if, as long as it's in compliance with what God's word says, we are giving the right answers. So, for example, now it's said okay for people of the same sex to marry, because as long as they love each other, who can be against it? So they have again the word love that makes everything okay. And of course, if you go by that definition, there's no end, because if you love your pet, you can also marry your dog or horse or whatever. And indeed this happens. And last week a guy went to court in America because he wanted to marry his computer, because he loves his computer, and this was not allowed. So he went to court to fight this. And I'm sure, maybe not him, but at some point in the near future, this will be okay. Because who can say that he does not really, genuinely love this computer? So, and people have married trees and all kinds of crazy things. And of course, as Christians, we know this is against God's word. This is absolutely not the way God has defined love, and certainly not marriage. So what is love? There are two ways to look at it, roughly. One way is the way of the world, and the other way is the way of God. And of course, it's the most easy thing for us to see and to understand is the way of the world, that is closer to our nature. And so I want to look at an example of worldly love that maybe, well, it should give us a feeling, yes, this is love. And it has everything to do with this picture, and maybe you, most likely, I'm pretty sure you have seen it before. I don't know if there are any people who have not seen it, actually. It's a very famous picture, and it's usually titled Praying Hands, which was not the original title. The original title was Hands, without the praying. And there's a story behind it that I want to share. Maybe you know it, but anyway. And it's all about love. The story plays about 500 years ago in the 15th century in a village near Nuremberg. And there was a family with 18 children. So the father had to work many hours every day to support his very big family. And he could barely make enough money to keep them all fed. And then the two eldest sons, Albrecht and Albert, Dürer was their last name, they had a dream. They wanted to go into art. And they wanted to go to the academy in Nuremberg to study art. But they understood that the father could never pay for this. So while they were late at night in their bed talking about their dreams, they came up with this idea, let's toss a coin, and the one who wins will go to the academy, and the one who loses will go to work in the mines nearby to support the other one. And so they did this, and Albrecht won. And so he went to the academy, and Albert went into the very dangerous mines to work to pay for his brother's education. And then Albrecht was very successful at the academy. He, right away, everything he created, etchings, woodworks, was much better than his professor's works, as he was very good. And even before he graduated, he was already making money with what he created. And so, after 4 years, he returned to his village, and the family had a big dinner to celebrate the graduation, and they were all a big family, obviously, all talking and having a good time. And after the meal, Albrecht stood up and he rose the glass, and he wanted to make a toast to his brother, who sacrificed 4 years of his life to make it possible that he could study. And he said, so now, Albert, my blessed brother, it's your turn. You can now go to study and I will support you. And Albert, who sat at the other end of the table, you can imagine with 18 children, it was a big table. He sat at the other end and he was just hanging his head and nodding and saying, no, 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 no. And he was crying. And after a few minutes, he pulled himself together and he said, no, brother, I cannot go. It's too late for me now. And he showed his hands and he said, in these 4 years, every bone has been broken at least once. And I have arthritis lately. So I cannot even raise the glass to answer your toast, let alone that I can do art. It's impossible. It's too late. And so he not only sacrificed 4 years, but he sacrificed his dream. And now, we all know this drawing. Although Albrecht Dürer's work is in every major museum all around the world, but this is actually what we know from him. And this he made after that the dinner. To honor his brother, he drew his brother's hands. And so that's what it is. It's actually not praying hands, but it's broken hands. Broken hands and a broken dream. But that's certainly what we could call love. It's brotherly love, Philadelphia. It's love indeed, and it's also sacrificial love. And that makes it maybe special. And I think that's something we have to keep in mind also when we continue. Love has this component of sacrifice. Although in this case it was not intended. Of course, Albert had not intended to break his hands and to lose his whole career. It was never intended that way. But it happened nevertheless. And so it's touching, and it should be, and it's a noble deed, what happened there. But in this whole story, God is not involved at all. And so this, only from that we can know this is not the love that Jesus speaks about. It's worldly love, and sometimes worldly love really is impressive and really peaks, but it's not what Jesus is talking about. For us it's very hard to actually understand what sacrificial love means. Sacrificial love is love where you are focused 100%, not 99 or whatever, 100% on the other. It's love that only gives and does not receive, only gives. And it's very difficult for us to get that there is love without self-interest. It's actually something we cannot produce by our own nature, because our nature is selfish. It's our very nature. And the Bible gives some sort of description of this love. By chance, we read it yesterday here, but I want to read it now as well. In 1 Corinthians 13, it's a famous chapter where Paul gives, inspired by the Holy Spirit, a very good description of love and what it's worth. And in doing so, he inserts a few very interesting statements, but I will not sidetrack to go in there, but maybe another time. So, 1 Corinthians 13, he said, "Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not love, I am become a sounding brass, or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains, and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not love, it profited me nothing." And here come a few very powerful verses. "Love suffers long, and is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth not itself, and is not puffed up. It does not have itself unseemingly, seeketh not her own. It does not behave itself unseemly, and seeketh not her own. Is not provoked, and thinketh no evil. Rejoice not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Love never fails, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But that which is perfect is come. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away." And, well, let me just finish this chapter here. "When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child." You might ask yourself, why does he say this now? In a way, he's saying this is not child stuff here. This is mature mature subject. Later on, he also says this is meat. This is not milk. And so, when I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. And you see also here the action. He put away the childish things. Because you can also become a man and hold on to your childish things. Actually, men have that tendency, especially men. So for now, we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as I know also am I am known. And now abideth in faith, hope, love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. It's very powerful chapter, and it's actually we do short to just read it like this and leave it at that, but maybe for another time, because this is really something to think about, every single verse. But for one thing, for this purpose, it shows love is not just a little thing, and it's not something you can apply to I love my computer or I love my dog or whatever. It's not like that at all. It goes much deeper. It's much more if we talk about the love that God has designed. And that also shows that it's not something we can just do. We cannot act it. And as we saw in this example, I just showed there, humanly love, worldly love can show some of the characteristics that we just read, but it cannot really fully be what God intends it to be. And I had to think of another example of worldly love that shows yet another characteristic of what we just read that love has. And it's a song that is maybe 50 years ago old, from the time that they wrote songs that had actually lyrics, that had a subject. It's called He Ain't Heavy, and the full title is He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother, and I will tell you where the title comes from. It was in 1884, when James Wells was in... went along the road. He was he worked for the United Free Church of Scotland, and he saw a little girl, maybe like 10 years old or something, or 12, something like that, and she was carrying a boy, a baby boy, but the boy was not a baby, he was also maybe 7 or so, a little bit younger than she, so almost as big as she was, and she was carrying the boy. And so he went to her and he said, saw her struggling, and he said, are you not tired? And she looked very surprised, as if he asked something very strange, and she said, he ain't heavy, he's my brother. Mm-hmm. And this statement was later picked up by someone who had a boys foster home, I think I say it correctly, in America, and this became the slogan of this this foster home. He ain't heavy, he's my brother. Because all these boys there, many of them were actually brothers, were from the same family, they had to help each other by lack of parents. And you see the love of the girl determined the weight of the burden, not the kilos or the size. And that shows what love can do. I want to read a few lines from this song, because although it's a really worldly song, but the lyrics really give some of the characteristics that also Paul writes, that we just read from 1 Corinthians 13. It's, by the way, it's from the Hollies, this song, if you want to look it up. It says, let me start at the beginning. The road is long with many a winding turn that leads to who knows where, who knows when, but I'm strong, strong enough to carry him. He ain't heavy, he's my brother. So on we go, his welfare is of my concern. No burden is he to bear. We'll get there, for I know he would not encumber me. He ain't heavy, he's my brother. And if I'm laden at all, I'm laden with sadness, that everyone's heart is not filled with the gladness of love for one another. It's a long, long road from which there's no return. And while we're on the way to there, why not share? And the load doesn't weigh me down at all. He ain't heavy, he's my brother. So again, it's sacrificial love. It's worldly love, but it shows at least something of what God means with love. And these examples are rare. Why? Because they go against our nature. This is not how man in general is. These are exceptions. And especially in our days, and this becomes very clear when Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3. He gives there how people will be in the last days. That's the times we live in. That's our days. And he speaks exactly about this subject. 2 Timothy 3, the first 2.5 verses. He writes, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful and unholy, without natural affection." I don't want to stop there. This, if you put this next to 1 Corinthians 13, it's the opposite. All the great things Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 13 about love, here it's the opposite. It's all the bad things that will come up in people, especially in the last days. The love is love of self, lovers of their own selves, and blaspheming and disobedient, unthankful and unholy. And then I wanted to head this first part of verse 3, without natural affection. This is unnatural. Yes, it's the nature of man, but it's not the nature that God wants man to have. It's when we follow our hearts and we follow what Satan, the direction that Satan points us. And this is so clear if you look around today and you see what a friend is, then you understand how true this is. So we talked about love, and now we switch to friend. This was the second keyword in this verse from John 15. We have friends nowadays to have fun. For us to have fun. Eh? So it's, I would say, it's usward, it's inward. It's for us. The friends have to bring pleasure to us. That's one purpose, if you will, for friend to have friends nowadays. And if it's not funny to be around this friend, then get rid of him or her. Or we have friends so that we feel better. It's nice to have people around you that adore you, that say that you're cool or good. So your own ego is boosted. And the word ego says everything. That's about me again. This is also very clear in social media. If you see Facebook, then you have friends in Facebook. Many friends, often, and many of which often you don't even know. You don't know really, or sometimes you haven't even seen them. They are friends or whatever. But we call them friends. And why do we like to have as many friends as possible in Facebook or in any other social media? Because the more friends we have, the more cool we are, the more popular we apparently are. So you see that people present themselves in Facebook not as they are, but the way they want others to see them, so that they will have more friends and they will be liked more, because likes, the more likes the better. And if your friends like what you like and you like what your friends like, then everything's good, and more friends will be added, etc. But it's all pointed to self. It's all inward. It is so far away from these two examples that we just saw, this this brother who worked in the mines, or this child carrying her brother. This is so completely a different universe, I would say. But that's how we have come in maybe the last example, 50 years, or this is how it is. And I'm mild, because it's actually much worse than this. So it's something completely different than the friendship that Jesus speaks about. If we go back to John 15, where we read verse 13, greater love had no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. So what does he mean with friend? That is actually very important to understand. We have to understand the word love, but we also have to understand the word friend. He continues in verse 14 there. He says, you are my friends. So John 15. You are my friends. He's not talking about friends in general, or Facebook friends or something like that. He says, you are my friends. Comma, if you do whatsoever I command you. There's a very clear condition there. And now you see, we get a bit more context, and then the verse gets a different weight. It's not just that he says great love when a man dies for his friend. He's talking, he says, you are my friend if you keep my commandments. So the friends he talks about are his friends that do his commandments. That's what he's talking about, actually. And then he says in verse 15, henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known to you. And some may say, well, this is a bit arrogant to say, and sorry for the words, because we're talking about Jesus, but some might think like that. We have to do whatever he says, and then we're friends. What kind of friendship is this? But if we go back to what is the definition of love, like we read in 1 Corinthians 13, it's actually fully self-sacrificial. It's not inward, it's outward. So if we love Jesus, we do everything for Jesus. And thus we do his commandments. It's only logic. There cannot be otherwise. That's how we show our friendship. And I'll get back to this. But that is truly brotherly love, Philadelphia. Now we also have to understand who is he speaking. And therefore we go back to chapter 13, verse 35, because that's basically where he starts to speak. And then he goes on all through the end of chapter 17. It's only Jesus speaking. So there it's chapter 13, verse 31 he starts, but we go to 35. And we also have this in one of the songs, We Are One in the Spirit. There is a line there that is from this verse. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love to one another. Here is again the word love, and he says, by that they will know that you are my disciples. So now we can equate friends, Jesus' friends, with Jesus' disciples. It's the same thing. Those are those that who are following his commandments. They are his disciples, but they're also his friends. So then still the question might remain, what does he mean to lay down our life? Does this then mean, okay, it's not that we die for just any friend, but does it mean that we have to die for Jesus? That we have to die as a martyr, maybe, for Jesus? Is that what he means? If we look at how we are, the flesh, then our life is the most valuable thing we have. As long as we breathe, we can do things. As soon as it stops, then life is gone, and we cannot change anything anymore. So laying down our life literally is actually the greatest and also the last gift we can give to someone. After that, we cannot do anything anymore. So indeed, there is no greater love because you cannot go over that. And it is exactly what Jesus did. He laid down his life for his friends. Not only that, he laid down his life for his enemies. And so there is greater love, but only he could do it. For his enemies, these are the ones that rejected him, that mocked him, that whipped him, that destroyed his body completely, and that killed him. For those, he died. So he went way beyond what he is actually asking from us. And in 1 Peter, this is reflected, 1 Peter 3, verse 18. For Christ had also once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. So the just for the unjust. He died not only for his friends, he died also for his enemies. But this verse also says, it's not a man dying for a man, it is God dying for man. And this makes it beyond our comprehension. God himself died for us. For us and for everyone. So it goes very deep if you think a bit about it. And now comes the difficult part, because Jesus sort of gives this as an instruction to us, and Paul repeats this in the letter to the Ephesians, Ephesians 5, verse 2. Ephesians 5, verse 2. And walk in love as Christ also had loved us, and hath given himself for us as an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. So this is an instruction. Walk in love as Christ also had loved us. So we have to imitate Christ. We have to imitate Jesus by walking in love. And it continues, and hath given himself for us as an offering. So he has given himself, here comes again, he laid down his life, and so we ought to imitate this. As he was a sacrifice, we also have to be a sacrifice, but it says of sweet smelling savor. So maybe you remember when we talked about the tabernacle, there are different offerings. There's the burnt offering when you enter the sanctuary, which is a picture of the cross. That's the sacrifice that Jesus did. That's what it speaks about here, the sacrifice. But then when you go way into the tabernacle, the very last thing before the ark is the altar of incense, the sweet-smelling savor that goes up to God, and that's prayers. That's our prayers in Jesus' name, because the fire under this is the fire from the altar of burnt offering. It can only be done through his sacrifice. So we don't need to literally go on the cross and die as he did. It's not to imitate in that way. But the question still remains, and we're going to answer it, how do we imitate this, and how do we lay down our lives? Now, interesting is that just last Friday, July 29th, it was, the Pope spoke in Poland. There was the World Youth Day. And he spoke about, among other things, about this. He said, and I quote, imitate Jesus, and it comes, through the 14 works of mercy, 7 corporal and 7 spiritual. So he talks here also about imitating Jesus with 14 works. And then later on he explains how we can do these works, and one of them is welcoming the pilgrims homeless. He used this word pilgrims homeless, which actually means the refugees. Yeah, or the immigrants, if you will. And he says also in his speech, quote, he, Jesus, wants you to be signs of his merciful love, here's the word love, of our time. He shows you the way of personal commitment and self-sacrifice. Interesting. It is the way of the cross, end quote. So he uses the same words, love, imitate Jesus, self-sacrifice. But then how? Through 14 works. Through 14 works of mercy. Where do I find this 14 works? They're not in the Bible. So the solution he's giving in how to imitate Jesus is non-scriptural. It's actually 14 things that you can easily do. And if this would be the way to get saved, would be an easy thing. But would also be an empty thing, actually. Because you can do these things with a vile heart, as a wicked person, and it doesn't mean anything. So this is not what Scripture tells us. Actually, the Bible tells us the opposite. It's not through works that we can be saved. The way of the cross, as the Pope calls it, is not through works. It's not something we can do on our own merit. So nevertheless, in Ephesians 5 verse 2, Paul writes, we ought to imitate Christ in love. How do we do this then? His greatest act of love was to lay down his life. And so for his friends. And so we also need to lay down our lives. Not physically, but in other ways. So we read in John 15 verse 14 that Jesus says, you are my friends. Now he's putting a label on us. On you and you and you and you. He says, you are my friend. So now we have a tag. Friend of Jesus. This gives us also something to do. Because he says, if greater love had no man than to lay down his life for his friend. So if we are a friend of Jesus, we ought to lay down our lives for Jesus. Our friend. Since he called us his friend. This is what friends do for each other. So, but there was a condition in verse 14 there. You are my friends if you do what I command you. It's not just as simple as just doing some works or just doing some things. No, we have to really follow him. That's why we read in John 13, he speaks to his disciples. Disciples are the ones that follow him. They have given up their life and they follow him. We talked about it a while ago, how when Jesus was calling his disciples the first time, he just went and he saw these two brothers there fishing and he said, come, follow me. And they just dropped their nets, they left their father in the boat and they went. That's what he asked. That's lay down your life. Throw away everything and follow me. Then you're a disciple. Then you do his commandments. His commandments simply means do what he says, what he asks you to do. So then, only then, his sacrifice gets value for us. It gets, it's purposed for us. As long as we don't answer his call, he still died for us, but we don't accept the gift, so it stays there. It's like you have your birthday, you get a gift, it's wrapped, and you don't unwrap it. So it just stays there. Useless. So we have to accept it. We have to answer. And that's why he says, you are my friend. He puts a tag on you, and now it's up to you to do something with this label. Now, of course, friendship needs to grow. It's not that you walk out in the street and you see someone and say, hey, from now on we're friends. Let's go have a drink. It doesn't work like that. That's not friendship. It has to grow. And it requires investment. It's a relationship. And Jesus is very specific if you read the context of John 13 through 17. He is speaking about friendship between him and his disciples, his followers, those that do his commandments. So it's an intimate friendship, and it finds its climax if you read through John in John 17, where Jesus is praying for his friends, knowing that he is going to leave the world and that he leaves his friends behind. And this worries him a lot. And you see, again, attributes of great love in his prayer in John 17. It's very intimate, this friendship, and very difficult for us to really understand. And I was thinking, just compare how you talk with a worldly friend, the language you use, the things you share, and then ask yourself, am I also just as comfortable when I speak to God? Can I do I share the same things? Do I use the same language? Is this just as comfortable as being next to a worldly friend? And if not, then this means that well, either one of the two relationships is probably not correct, but certainly you need to work on your relationship with God, because you should at least be comfortable. So the real message that Jesus is giving here is he's saying you have to give up your life for me. And again, it's not arrogance, it's actually offering a gift of salvation, because without that there is nothing. And we find this also in Luke, where he actually literally shares the same thing in Luke 9, verse 24. Luke 9, verse 24, he says, whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. That's exactly what he says. Lay down your life for a friend. And what do you get? You will get life. You lay down your life, but you don't lose it. You gain everything. And actually, the life that you lay down, it's not real life. It's actually death. It's also reflected in Ephesians. Paul says, before you were saved, you were dead in your trespasses, Ephesians 2. So we have to lay down this life, get rid of this darkness, enter into the light, and again, it's not some arrogant person saying, you have to do everything for me, otherwise you cannot be my friend. No, he says, lay down your life for me, do as I command, and you will receive the full gift that I have given in laying down my life for you. And that's salvation. That is the gift. And this verse that we just read from Luke 9, verse 24, it's so important. It's written 6 times throughout the 4 Gospels. You can find it also in Luke 17, verse 23, in Matthew 16, verse 25, in John 12, verse 25, in Matthew 10, verse 39, and in Mark 8, verse 35. So 6 verses that say the exact same thing. Whosoever will save his life shall lose it. Whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. So apparently it's important. It's important, and it's actually the key. Without that, without giving up your life, there's no way to salvation. And I go back to John. John 14, verse 15. Because Jesus has said, you are my friends if you keep my commandments. In John 14, verse 15, he says, if you love me, keep my commandments. So you see here again how the word friend is linked to love. You are my friends if you keep my commandments. If you love me, you keep my commandments. So you are my friend if you love me, and then you keep my commandments. It's all the same. And so the third keyword basically that we could add to friend and love is obedience. It's obedience. These three are linked. It is very clear in this verse that we just read, John 14, verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. And if you go to the next chapter, chapter 15, verse 14, if you are my friends, do whatsoever I command you. Just put these two verses next to each other, 14, 15 and 15, 14, and you see how they form a chain. It's like a chain. It's all linked together. And it's interesting that it's 14, 15 and 15, 14, but it's easy to remember. And then in chapter 14, verse 16, then he adds on top of the fact that through this we get salvation because we accept the gift that he laid down his life for us. On top of that, he gives another promise, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. And he's talking about the Holy Spirit. So he's saying basically, if you do that, you will receive the Holy Spirit. And there are many more verses that explain this, of course. And that is again very interesting, because Jesus is completing the circle. He is actually saying, I'm at the door, I knock, you have to open. So that's the action you have to do. Yes, he put a tag on us. You are my friend if you do my commandments. So that's our action. We have to do this. But once we do, the door is opened. Now we are in a relationship and we receive the Spirit. And what does the Spirit do? Galatians 5:22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. The very first of nine things is love. And you see how it's full circle. Because love, friendship, obedience, receiving the Spirit, producing love, and now you can stay in this relationship, because otherwise you would have to make this step every time again. And it's just extremely hard at times, because the enemy is not resting. But now when the Spirit indwells you and start to grow in you and become stronger, it becomes much more easy to keep obeying Jesus and stay in this circle of love and friendship. And then this relationship of friendship can grow. It is also what King Solomon speaks about in Ecclesiastes, when he speaks about this threefold court. He first says, when someone is alone, he's actually miserable. Because when he falls, who can pick him up? So two is better than one, he says. But then he continues. Later on, a bit later, he writes, but a threefold cord cannot be broken. So why three? It's two persons and God. Yeah, and we know now it's through Jesus and the working of the Holy Spirit that the full Godhead works. But that's like the cement between the bricks. That's what holds them together. And so this is Ephesians 4 verse 12 if you want to write it down. And this is also what Paul alludes to in Ephesians 5 when he speaks about wives and husbands. It's the same thing. But he says, wives, submit yourself to your husband as Jesus submitted himself to the church. So it's again, he says, imitate Jesus' love. And then a bit lower, he says, husbands, love your wives as Jesus has loved the church. It's the same thing. So it's this triangle, this threefold cord. Only in that way it works. If you break one of the three legs, so to speak, it doesn't work. So it's actually a very basic principle that we have to understand. And so we're almost there. And one example of this where all these three comes together, this obedience, this friendship and love, is in Abraham. And it's often said, but there is no Jesus in the Old Testament and there is no Holy Spirit in the Old Testament. This is not true. And we have seen many examples, of course, the past weeks. But the full Godhead is at work in the very same way, right from the beginning until the very end. God is the same through all times. And it's certainly also so with Abram. I think I mentioned a while ago this example where God makes the covenant with Abram. He puts a deep sleep upon Abram. Abram falls asleep, and in his sleep he gets a vision. And in the vision he sees this bull, I think it is, that is split in two. And the two halves are on the floor. And this is something they used to do in those days when they made a covenant in general, for example, two kings would become allies. They made a covenant. They would cut a bull in half, put the two halves on the ground, and both would walk in between. And they would say, if any one of us breaks our covenant, he will have the same fate as this bull. So it was like a strong bond to confirm the covenant. So this is what God showed Abram in his vision. And in the vision, Abram sees a big pillar of fire going in between these two halves. That's God. We know the pillar of fire later goes in front of the Israelites at the Exodus. So God goes through. And then it's actually Abram's turn, because it's a covenant between God and Abram. It's Abram's turn to go. But in the vision, what does Abram see? He sees a small flame going through. Not himself, but a small flame. It's also a flame. It's the same substance as God. It's actually Jesus. Jesus did it for him, because he could never do it. He was a mere human. So this is just one of many examples where you can actually see how God is working the same way actually all through times. And we see it, of course, also in Abram's very name, Abram to Abraham, where this fifth letter of the Hebrew alphabet is added, where five is the number of grace. It's the five wounds of Jesus. So it's there all the time. It's beautiful. And in Abram, the whole example that we are talking about is shown. He literally gave up his life by answering God when God told him, you leave your country and you go to where I will lead you. So he was very comfortable and doing very well where he lived, but he left everything behind and he went to a destination that he didn't know actually. And that was obedience. And it was also a God that he didn't know. Just think of this, because we know so much about God and what he did afterwards with Moses and all these things. Abram did not know any of this. This was all future. He was answering a God that he didn't know. But he heard God and he obeyed. It's if you really think of it, it's actually very special what and how strong his faith was. So he gave up his life and he went to a land that he didn't know. He also, later on, he gave up again his life in another way, because he had one son, he had two sons, Ishmael and Isaac, but one son was of his wife, Sarah, that was Isaac. That's why it says in Genesis 22, verse 2, now go to the mountain which I will show you, and you sacrifice your only begotten son. It's these words that are being used there, your only begotten son. And it's, of course, the very same words we read in the New Testament. God gave his only begotten son. And it's a picture of that. But God had promised him a great offspring. And finally, after such a long time, he had a son, Isaac, that had now grown up, actually. And now God tells him, you go and sacrifice him. That would break the covenant. That would make it impossible. He was way over 100 years, because he was 100 years when Isaac was born. So there was no way he would get another son and this would all happen again. Yet he did not ask questions. He obeyed. He was sure if God would tell him to sacrifice him, God would also raise him from the dead and God would do a miracle. He was very obedient. And through that, this obedience, we read in James 2, verse 23, and the scripture was fulfilled, which said, Abram believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. So here you see everything in one verse. He believed God, he obeyed God, and he received the righteousness of God. This is the grace that we know it comes through Jesus. And he was called a friend of God. So Jesus calls you and me to to be his friend or to become his friend. And he tells you and me to give our lives, to lay down our lives for him and obey his commandments. Not because he puts a knife on our throat, so to speak, but out of love. And then he gives this extra promise on top of salvation, he will give us the Holy Spirit. And only then we are able to produce, to keep producing this love that we need in order to make this relationship of friendship grow. It's a love that 1 Corinthians 13 describes. Through the Holy Spirit, yes, we are able to produce this. Without, there's no way. And the examples I showed before, as I said, these are exceptions, and of course, these are just incidents, so to speak. We don't know anything else about the lives of these people. Of course, as human beings, we can do wonderful things. Sometimes we can peak, but it's only when the Spirit of God indwells us that we can really live according to His will and produce love and works that go over what we can humanly do. That's why it is spiritual fruit. And it's the first of the 9 attributes that we read in Galatians 5:22. The first is love. And it's so sad that this word is so devalued nowadays. Because if you go to the real meaning, it is so beautiful. So rich. So he laid down his life for you and for me, and so it's up to us to lay down our lives for him, and we will be his friends. Amen.